Thank you. Congregation may stand and face the back center aisle. It is the festival of All Saints. From the letter to the Hebrews, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who, for the sake of the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. O God of the Pilgrim's Way, we give thanks for those in generations past who have been examples for us of God's love at work in the world. As we worship and pray this day, we know that we are surrounded by this great rejoicing cloud of witnesses. Yet, even as we name those holy ancestors, we thank God for others whose names we never knew or have forgotten, who showed us the meaning of life in Christ. We give thanks and praise. We too seek to do your will.
Guide us.
We too desire to be your servants.
Strengthen us.
We too long to know you clearly.
Teach us.
Thank you.
remembrance of the faithful departed, you may be seated. We remember before God this day those whom the Lord has called home during the past year, grateful for their memory, looking forward to a blessed reunion in heaven.
Dorothy Sharp. Evelyn Purdy. William Bill Borison.
I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. Everyone who lives and believes in me will never die.
Irene Kopostinsky. Richard Dick Rathje. David Sims.
God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain.
Clifford Freimeyer. Eleanor Ruge. Lorraine Stoltenberg.
I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day.
Albert M. Merv Hansen. Norm DeHardy. Phyllis Harrison.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life.
Jordan Meyer. Wanda Rauert. Ken Gannat.
Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life.
Laura Findlay. Sally Wenzel.
We remember this day also all our beloved faithful departed not named here, but whom we now name in our hearts. A time of silence. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, your people are knit together in one communion. In the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, And with you and the Holy Spirit, we worship and praise one God, now and forever. Time I share with you the memorial gifts that we have received and share a prayer of dedication and blessing. The memorial gifts to the undesignated fund include gifts in memory of Evelyn Purdy and Lorraine Stoltenberg this past year. The undesignated fund is used throughout the year for various purchases and ministries as approved by the Memorial Committee and Church Council. Gifts to this fund include the following: Bibles for use in the fireside room and elsewhere in our church, the child care and preschool playground, a baptismal pitcher for the chapel, an additional communion set for our home communion ministry, and liturgical binders for leaders in worship. From the designated fund, the following gifts were received and directed to various ministries of our church: the completion of the renovation of the fireside room was made possible for memorial gifts in memory of Rudy, Harry, and Clara Soth. For new faith formation ministry, in memory of Sarah Wilkins. For the We're Debt Free ministry, in memory of Clifford Freimeyer. For the Richard and Jerry Scholarship Fund, in memory of Richard Rathje. For the Prayer Garden, in memory of Eleanor Ruge. For the Rowart Agriculture Scholarship, in memory of Wanda Rowart. And for the completion of a purchase that began the previous year for the new Advent wreath candelabrum, in memory of Rudy, Harry, and Clara Soth. Also for choir ministry and for child care and preschools, for choir ministry in memory of Rudy, Harry, and Clara Soth. And finally, for child care and preschool scholarships and for the child care and preschool playground in memory of Ken Gannott. We pray. On this Festival of All Saints, we thank you, O God, as we recognize these memorial gifts and dedicate them to the ministries of your church, to your glory and praise. Grant us faith to know your gracious purpose in all things, and give us joy in them, and lead us to the building up of your kingdom. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our first reading this morning is from the book of Wisdom. The souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be a disaster, and their going from us to be their destruction. But they are at peace. For though in the sight of others they were punished, their hope is full of immortality. Having been disciplined a little, they will receive great good, because God tested them and found them worthy of himself. Like gold in the furnace, he tried them, and like a sacrificial burnt offering, he accepted them. In the time of their visitation, they will shine forth and will run like sparks through the stubble. They will govern nations and rule over peoples, and the Lord will reign over them forever. Those who trust in him will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with him in love. Because grace and mercy are upon his holy ones, and he watches over his elect. The word of the Lord.
The Holocaust is a stunning reminder of the tragic results of prejudice and hate toward other people. But it is also a reminder that hope held firm will eventually reign victorious over the greatest of odds. The following words were inscribed on the walls of a cellar in Cologne, Germany, where Jews were hiding from the Nazis during World War II. Hope was all they had to hold on to. Hope was their only bridge to a brighter tomorrow.
Thank you.
Our second reading is from the book of Revelation. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." And then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end." The word of the Lord.
Please stand. Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain. And after he sat down, his disciples came to him, and then he began to speak, and he taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Again on this All Saints Festival, an array of candles burning before us, a gentle, quiet beauty in the candlelight, calling to remembrance all those we have entrusted to the Lord from this congregational family, from our own families, all who are in the body of Christ, all who belong to that great cloud of witnesses, as we heard in the opening proclamation. Here on this All Saints Day, I will be adding something else to that display and talking about it with you. You may recognize it. It is an old-fashioned wooden cane. And in the realm of television drama series, one of the great characters is House, and this cane is synonymous with House. That's Dr. Gregory House, the great Sherlock Holmes of diagnostic medicine, solving impossible cases. Just as the smoking pipe is associated with Sherlock Holmes, so the cane, synonymous with House. Some days ago, late at night, I'm in bed watching TV. Betty has drifted off to sleep, and I'm watching an episode of House. And in this episode, as it's ending, House is talking with his good friend, Dr. Wilson. And House has discovered something that he did not know earlier. Unbeknownst to him, someone who he thought had been discharged in a condition that they were unable to change, unbeknownst to him, the person had actually been cured. House had suggested a radical off-the-wall treatment, a diagnosis that didn't fit the medical bill at all, and he was overruled. This gentleman confined to a wheelchair, trapped in that wheelchair, trapped in his brain, unresponsive except for open eyes, unable to communicate, no one knowing if he could communicate. And unbeknownst to House, at the last moment, as the man was being discharged, his superior, Dr. Cuddy, gave him the medicine, the injection, just as a last-ditch effort, and it was the correct diagnosis and prescription. The brain came to life, and the man began to speak, and in a faltering way began to stand and take a step. Now, House, at the end of the episode, has learned what he thought had failed was actually a great success. And he turns to Wilson, and he says, "Why didn't you tell me?" And he says, "We didn't tell you because you would have thought you were God." And House has a problem with humility. "We thought you would think of yourself as God." And House looks at Wilson with a sneer and takes his cane and limps off, turning back, saying, "God doesn't limp." The show ended on that note. Turned off TV. Turned off the lamp, and I pondered that. House with his cane, sneering, "God doesn't limp." And I pondered that question in the darkness of the night, pondered it for a good while. Does God limp? Does the God you worship, put your faith in, put your hope in, does he limp? Does he use a cane? As I pondered that question, I thought back to my confirmation class days when I was a young boy, and I remember the old blue catechism that some of us grew up with. We had Luther's small catechism at the beginning, and then page after page after page with all of these endless questions with unequivocal answers and proof text Bible passages explaining the nature of God and everything else. I suppose God worked through all of that because here I am today along with others. But in that catechism, as I laid on my pillow in the dark of night thinking about God, does he limp? I remembered from the catechism how it said in no uncertain terms the nature of God. God is omniscient. He's all-powerful. God is all-knowing. God is omnipotent, all-powerful. God is omnipresent. Everywhere. Omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent, great alliteration, nowhere a hint of any limp, any cane there. And I think if I would have raised my hand in confirmation class and asked the teacher, "Does God limp?" she would have looked at me as a sassy kid, maybe even sacrilegious, and say, "God doesn't limp. He's omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent." So is the God as presented to us perhaps early on in life. But we who have lived life, how is it? Does God limp? As we ponder that question. For sure, we, this side of heaven, limp. We use canes, wheelchairs, walkers. We lived enough years, the joints begin to ache, do they not? Some of us get new hips, new knees, backs give out. Oh yes, we limp. And that's just talking about our physical body. And if we were to tell the tale of our soul, our spirit, we would share the stories of how in life we have gone through great agonizing experiences, difficult suffering, heartache losses, experiences that wound us to the core of our being and forever leave us changed. And we walk away from those experiences limping in our spirit, in our soul. We bear those wounds. For sure, this side of heaven, we limp. I always have to smile when I read those famous verses from Hebrews chapter 12. Great, great verses. One of my favorites. But those verses have a lot of bravado, do they not? They say, because we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, let's cast off the burdens and shed the sins and let us run with perseverance the race that's set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. And here I am now growing old, thinking, I think my running days are over. Great image, run the race, but I don't know. I think when I reach the finish line, whenever that may be, soon or later in life, when I reach that finish line, I'm going to be hobbling with a cane rather than running a race. This is how it is for us in life, this side of heaven. As I pondered the meaning of limping and the question, does God limp, I was drawn to a very strange story in Genesis, one of the strangest stories in the Bible, and it deals with limping at the end. It's a story of Jacob, Jacob wrestling God, Genesis chapter 32. If you know the story of Jacob, as a teenager, fled for his life because his twin brother Esau wanted to kill him because Jacob had tricked him out of his inheritance. He fled for his life. He went to live with Uncle Laban far away. And over the years, he married and he had family and he prospered. And now it's time to return home to see if he might reconcile with his brother Esau. And he arrives near his brother's land, the stream, the Jabbok stream there, dividing him from his brother. And he sends his family across, but he stays that evening on this side of the Jabbok. And he falls to sleep among the reeds of the stream. And in the night, a stranger descends on him, and it's a life and death struggle. And in the struggle, Jacob begins to sense that this stranger is God, wrestling with God. He's got God in his hands, and he won't let him go. Strange story, as I said. And in the struggle, God strikes Jacob in the hip, tearing the ligaments and the tendons, crippling him for life. But Jacob tenaciously holds on. In the struggle, he holds on to God. He will not let him go. And as the dawn light appears, God says, "Let me go." And Jacob says, "No, not until you bless me." And then God blesses him. God also says, you deserve a new name. There's a deeper identity to you, Jacob, than your name, Jacob, which meant rascal. I call you Israel, the great name given, Israel, for you have striven with God. Jacob released God. And when the sun came up, Jacob, now Israel, went off on the journey of the rest of his life, and he didn't run, and he could barely walk. He limped. He walked with a cane the rest of his life. I find that story fascinating because it says something of our own relationship to God And it will lead also to an understanding of God that I want to share with you. As many of you know, our daughter Angie died years ago. You too could tell those kinds of stories, many of you. It happened so quickly. It was as if God came upon us in the night, and a great struggle began. A struggle none of us were ready for. Certainly a struggle that our daughter Angie did not deserve, but that is the nature of life. And there were many times in the course of that struggle that I asked God why, and that I prayed for a miracle. Now, I never gave up on God. I never doubted his promises or his love for us. But many times that struggle brought me to my knees. And shortly thereafter, we laid Angie to rest and gave her back to God. Another journey began, journey of grief. God did not give me or our family or to Angie that miracle, and he certainly didn't give answers. What he gave is his promise and his presence, which is love. Gave me a cane to walk with. I walk with that cane, as many of you too walk with that cane that I have described. I look into the mirror, I am to see the image of God in that mirror, and I see myself marked by the sufferings of life. You look into the mirror. You see the image of God, also your life marked by suffering and losses, and other challenges. Many of you walk with a cane, the cane that we have been describing. We bear that image of God, and that image lends me to believe, since we are created in the image of God and are to see the image of God in all of our life, even as we age and experience these things, then surely God must limp. It is his image. God is the God of love, not just of omnipotent power. There are great powers that hold the universe together, the physicists say, but the greatest power of all that holds everything together, everything, even those represented in candles, together with us with them, that power is love. It's at the very heart of God. And if that power is love, as we describe it time after time here in worship, in our life together as the body of Christ, then we know that love bears suffering, that it bears heartache, and it bears promise and hope. And as the anthem said, even when the todays are stripped away, the hope is left for tomorrow. This is the nature of God. This is the nature of love. I picture God limping from the very beginning now. There in the Garden of Eden, beautiful story filled with symbolic and spiritual truth. And because of that, I can feel free to picture it this way. Picture God closing the gates of paradise, Adam and Eve banished from the garden, and God looking at them with some longing in his heart as they go off and as he returns to his place of rest. And I see him as he turns to go back, limping, heartache, shattered hope, longing in his heart to be reunited with his Adam and Eve. I see God limping. Cane in hand, tree branch, whatever it may be. In the gospel readings, I say Jesus, the man who came to be among us, to share all of our life that he might share his life with us. And what he shares with us is his love, his own heartache and suffering. He is the man of sorrows who shares in our sorrows. One body of Christ We're all in this together. I see him at the grave of his dearest friend Lazarus, crushed under grief, they said. He fell in a cataclysm of grief, weeping there at the tomb. I picture Mary and Martha, or maybe the other disciples, his cane in that moment, holding him, giving him strength. And when he went the way of the cross, they called on others to help him bear that cross, because it was too much for him. Yes, God limps. And the amazing thing about that cross is that Jesus turns that cross into the greatest image of his love. It's like the cane put in our hands. And when the journey is hard, we lean even harder on that cane. Does God limp? Well, you know where I stand. And I believe if you look into the mirror and see your image, you will see the image of God whose love is with you, who never forsakes you, even in the greatest mysteries, even in the deepest losses of life. And that love is powerful. There is great strength in that cane that you lean on, great strength in the cross of Christ's love. Yes, God limps. He has a cane. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to stand as we sing.
Thank you.
With the people of God gathered here and throughout the world, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. Lord God, sovereign of all creation, draw us into your presence and transform us to be a holy people. Bless us through your word and holy meal to show your uncommon love to others. Lord, in your mercy, move us to reinvigorate polluted waters and air, renew fallow fields, and revive natural habitats that have been destroyed. Open our eyes to the bounty you have given us and inspire us to tend to it. Lord, in your mercy, fill our public servants and we who elect them to office with your wisdom. Let your justice flow through our governments and our institutions. Lord, in your mercy, unbind those who are burdened by illness or grief. Wipe away the tears of those who cannot see your life through the weight of their affliction. Be with those who will die today. Lord, in your mercy, strengthen and bless this congregation's ministries of outreach, healing, and hospitality. Make us eager to receive those you send to us. Lord, in your mercy, we bless you for the lives of the saints who now rejoice in your salvation face to face. Join us with all whom have made righteous and preserve us in eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, enfold all things into your compassion, O God, and bring us into your life through the faithfulness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share the peace with one another.
Before we stand for the great Thanksgiving, just a few notes to bring to your attention. The Tables of Grace Ministry has their organizational meeting tonight. If you signed up for that, be sure to note the details. If you haven't signed up and would like to be a part of that ministry, it is not too late. The new members group will start this Wednesday at 6:30. Come and grow with us. It'll be in the fireside room. Alpha Sigma out in the lobby will be selling containers of honey. We welcome your purchases as we do each year. These purchases of honey support the Ark Ministry of Central Nebraska. And finally, two notes. Steve Meising, the assistant to the bishop, will be our special guest next week, sharing with us the ministry of the church beyond our congregation, helping us see that mission. And Pastor Bill is not with us today, but he is preaching in Nebraska. We have a number of churches in our cluster that are in transition. They're without pastors, and not all of those spots have been filled yet with transition pastors. So Pastor Bill, who is the dean for our cluster, is helping out. And since we have several leaders here that can hold the home front, we're sharing him with other churches from time to time throughout the fall. I invite you to stand. We sing the first two stanzas of Let O Mortal Flesh Keep Silence. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy God, you alone are holy. You alone are God. The universe declares your praise beyond the stars, beneath the sea, within each cell, with every breath.
We praise you, God.
Generations bless your faithfulness through the water, by night and day, across the wilderness, out of exile, into the future. We give you thanks for your dear Son, at the heart of human life, near to those who suffer, beside the sinner, among the poor, with us now. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering his love for us on the way, at the table, and to the end, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. We pray for the gift of your Spirit in our gathering, within this meal, among your people, throughout the world. Blessing, praise, and thanks to you, Holy God, through Christ Jesus, by your Spirit and your Church without end. Amen. We sing. Let us join hands as we pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, you may be seated. Hunger no more, thirst no more, come to the banquet of life. Congregation may stand. Now may this body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. Sovereign God, in this meal you give us a foretaste of the great feast to come. Keep us faithful to you, that we, with all your saints, may at length celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The love of God surround you, the grace of Christ release you, and the Holy Spirit be your guide and strength now and forevermore. Amen.
Led on by the saints before us, go in peace to serve the Lord.